So the question that I wanted to ask you right away is, how many times have you watched since you made it?
Many times. And when you first make it, of course, you always want to watch it because you feel, "Mera bachcha kitna sundar hai," type of thing. But lately, and then you start hating it. And now lately, it's been shown a lot because of the love jihad thing. So in the last few weeks, I've watched it too many times.
So there's this odd thing happening to you, right? This 2006, you made a film about women in toilets. And the only people who wanted to give you an award at that point was the Plumbing Association of Mumbai. Correct? And now, day before yesterday, you were in a conversation about the same thing with Amitabh Bachchan. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Yeah. And suddenly, Love Jihad, which was like this cute heart-shaped thing, is now like national agenda, and everybody's trying to discuss whether it's going to work in Maharashtra, it's not going to work in Maharashtra. Mm. Perhaps it will work in that. So, what has happened to this conversation, which was narrowly enjoyed in within the film screening world or within an activist world? What has happened to that conversation now?
I mean, I think it's very interesting because I also have been thinking a lot about it, that, you know, you already know, like, your starting position as a documentary filmmaker is that it's not going to make any difference, but you hope it's going to make a difference. No, I don't believe, actually, that films don't make a difference. I deeply believe they make a difference, otherwise I wouldn't make them. I just don't think they make the kind of difference people expect from them. I think something else happens. So one part of me, the vain part or the idealistic part, which are the same thing, would like to believe that by raising these conversations and those conversations traveling outwards, they become something. At least with the toy, that is true. That, you know, when I was making Qtopia, I couldn't find anything. I was working very hard to research the film, and it was difficult to make the film. And I took the longest ever to make that.
You couldn't find any data.
No data. No people working on it. It was a struggle. Like, how to even construct or understand the film. So it took me long to do it. But then a lot of people use that film in the most traditional, practical way that you are told. No, documentary should serve social change. So I was like, wow, that's never what I planned to do, and it happened. And I think a huge number of people have done stuff on the ground with public toilets and the government and the media and whatever. Some of it is a real thing that people have begun to talk about. Feminism being discussed more because of sexual violence being discussed more, all those things. But I think right now there's a very clever kind of appropriation of that work that people have done into something that is going to be done for the first time in the country, as if nobody's ever talked about toilets or what women, the problems women face. That's not been true, because tons of organizations have been working in the last 6 years, and there have been many sanitation programs. Love Jihad is obviously a much more interesting thing, because I never heard this term. It was not reported anywhere in the media when I was researching the Operation Majnu story. It's only when I went to Meerut that people were, "Are wo love jihad bolte na, wo VHP wale love jihad bolte na." I was like, what is that? This thing is made for me, type of thing. So And which is why the name of the film used to be only Morality TV, and then it changed to that. But after the film was made, you know, it was interesting because the whole Mutalik thing happened right soon after. And I remember being very disappointed because people didn't actually use Morality TV for screenings and to raise discussions about moral policing in the way I imagined that they should or would. I mean, both Qtopia and Morality TV were made out of something you feel is happening to you, around you. If the principal of St. Xavier's College can't wear sleeveless t-shirts to college, then you start thinking, like, what's going on in Bombay and why is this happening here? So film comes out of that impulse. You think that people will use it. Nobody uses it. And I think that agenda, the only reason now lots of activist groups call and they want to use this film is because it's become a BJP versus secular liberals issue, which is, I think, not what it really is. You know, it's always been an issue of what's happening in people's lives, how are people exercising their agency, how are people marrying across lines, making decisions that are counter to tradition. And it's a pity that when it's something to do with personal, private life and private choices, love, sexuality, etc., that the larger political activist establishment does not take up issues. And it therefore allows other forces to set the agenda for how we're going to discuss these issues. No? So I think, like, in the two issues of toilets and love jihad, very different kinds of things have been happening. So I feel almost sorry when people invite me to show the film now, because I feel like, is doing it when somebody else is deciding what you should be saying about it, when you could have talked about it differently before.
And to some extent, you were saying in another context that this particular conversation about love jihad has been going on from the 1920s?
Earlier.
Yeah. So it's come back into the conversation, and it's very, like, clearly being marketed in one sense. But there is also a particularity to Meerut. I think there's a character in the film who says something about Meerut being a TRP city and how that affects things. Mm. And again, just now, the whole reconversion and gang rape story also came out of Meerut. So do you see a pattern here?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's the, you know, I only went to make the film in Meerut because Operation Majnu happened and I saw it on TV. It was that simple. And I was like, what is this thing? Something is happening here and I should go and find out. It's only when I went that I began to understand what is particular about Meerut, that it's a town with very, it's been a dense, tiny place with very complex histories, right? Like it's been a university town, but it's also a place where a lot of pulp fiction is published and a lot like Manohar Kahaniya and all that kind of publication. There's like salacious Hindi B-type magazines and Nichle Star, they call it the Nichle Star ki magazines, are published and consumed. But it also has a history of communal violence. It also was included in the NCR around that time. So there's a kind of economic change happening. People want part of that change. There was a lot of prosperity for Muslims happening through the meatpacking industry at the time that I went to make the film. So there's a kind of economic dynamic. There's many, many dynamics. Operation Majnu and Loving Jihad idea, actually, which is what I discovered about Meerut. So that became a fascinating thing for me. But the idea of Meerut being a TRP city is that, you know, TRPs are how you decide what channel is at the top, how many people are watching what. It's a very flawed system. I won't go into too many details of it. But basically, only certain city centers are the places from which TRPs are gauged. So Patna, Meerut will be one. A certain number of people, like somewhere in between big city and smaller town, and Meerut is one of those cities. That's why you, if you really think about, ever since the breaking news 24-hour television cycle began, a number of the important Kands, the kind of what they call a Kand, so Majnu Kand, and there was one more Kand while we were shooting over there, I'm forgetting. Like, you know, so these kind of stories actually occur all the time, noirish kind of stories. But you'll always hear them coming out of Meerut because there's a TRP that is gauged, and if Meerut stories are played, then people will watch. So it becomes a kind of, you play back an image of something to somebody, then it becomes that thing, and you know. You can find all these stories in Azamgarh or anywhere else, I think, actually.
So the form that you eventually chose of sort of looping in and out of fiction, in and out of pulp fiction, so going into sting footage and sort of, you know, fluidly going into conversations with this very self-satisfied pulp fiction writer. So did it emerge out of a certain atmosphericity of Meerut, or is it something that you went in wanting to play with the form?
Initially, when I set out to make the film, like before actually going to Meerut, I had not really thought to make the film in this way. So it had, it was a PSBT film, and every filmmaker has done a little breast beating about PSBT, which is because money is small. So you want to try to make the film in an efficient way, so that you don't run into like crazy economic problems. So I thought I should make a film which is in one place, which needs to be shot over a few days. It should be very, very like tight what I do here. I don't think I want to like spend 2 years making this film. So I went and I thought I'm just going to interview three people who are involved, like three different facets. But then I went and I discovered all these things. And of course, what I noticed, the first thing I noticed when I was doing research, is that every single reporter who had written about Operation Majnu was a crime reporter. That was the first thing that tipped me off, like, okay, this story is not being filed under whatever, whatever, but it is a crime story. So I went and met all those reporters who had written about it. And each one of them was a colorful character. Like, you know, in those days, mobile phones were not that common. And they'd have like two mobile phones, one for their khabris and one for the. And all of that world was interesting to me. But I also began to then, because I began recording like news television from the Shakti Kapoor sting operation onwards. Because at that time I began to feel, but I didn't know what it is that is happening. So I would just like randomly record TV news 1 or 2 hours every day kind of thing. So watching it, I began to understand that a certain kind of language is being used, a visual language as well as a verbal language that is saying certain types of things, that is making implication, which is connected to this longer tradition of Manohar Kahaniya and pulp fiction, and it's very full of innuendo and implication, right? And so I thought, well, then the film has to be like that. Also, I came away with so many Manohar Kahaniyas and detective fiction novels, and I began reading them, and I was like, actually, it's amazing, because we get some juice and beauty out of it. We get a certain excitement out of it. It also liberates us to talk about certain things, but it also really highly constrains and constricts us, right? And when it turns from something that is private and read to something that gets on so many cameras, where I'm going to trap you. I'm not just going to make a meaning out of what you've done, but I'm going to fix that meaning in a visual. And I'm going to say, it's you. it creates a different dynamic.
Yeah, that the girl who says what is it, park ki image bahut
down ho chuki hai, ha. So this idea of the image kis cheez ki down ho gayi, I should not be seen to do anything, that becomes very heightened when you're going into a television news cycle kind of thing. And you also see that all these stories about sting operations were always about these things. They were never about anything very political except for one or two, right? Every sting operation was massage parlor ke andar condom bechti hui mahila, that sort of thing. So you also start, then you see the pattern. So I thought, well, if I want to talk about how things are being said, then I should come up with a form which will mimic that, but somehow make you look at it differently. And then Sankalp, who edited the film, was really great in helping me to do that better, right? Like, he came up with the idea of the split screens and this news TV type of thing. But the other thing is also that the form of the film is not adhering strictly to that. So it's very dodgy, right? If you mimic something, you also become that. You have to be careful. And Mukul, who shot the film, had a very big fight with me during the shoot, because I wanted to shoot all those lovers who were in the park, and I wanted to shoot them on a long lens because you couldn't go up to them while they were canoodling behind the trees, no? Because I wanted to say that is the gaze which looks at them. And then Mukul was like, but by doing that, you are also doing what they're doing. So I'm like, yeah, but I'm doing it for a different reason. And so we had a very big argument and were sulking with each other for a while. But it's a genuine issue. Actually, in order to show that something is this way, you do it, but you do the same thing that you're critiquing. So how do you get out of that bind? It was a big question. And I think while we were filming also, which is why it's interesting, because the film is made very much to a script. But one thing we reacted to was we were feeling it's so negative, you know. We go out every day to interview people, and they all say, police ne jo kiya, theek kiya. Nobody is saying that police is like, you know, harami, they should not have beaten up young lovers, what is the big deal? So we're like, we can't make a film which is full of people. Every day we'll come home and drink whiskey and feel depressed. And we're like, we have to have something else. So we started looking for some young people. And that's like the Archie's shop, the heroes of the film in the Archie's shop, we happened upon them, which is the great magical thing about documentary. We were only going to shoot the Archie's shop, and then those boys were there and we started talking to them. And then we found these girls, Gunjali and others, through people we knew. So then when we were editing the film, I also thought that if it's a film about the gaze, then we should shift the gaze, our gaze. And so around the time that Priyanka, the girl who happened to be in the park, whom the cops beat up, from her interview onwards, the editing rhythm and the style of the film begin to change. So that, at least I hope, and that only the audience can say, that when the film finishes, you're not left with the physical residue of that gaze of TV, but you're just left with these very sweet balloons and my heart is beating and these kids holding hands. Because actually that's all it is. That's all it is. People are just foolish and doing sweet, silly things, and they get fixed in that moment forever by this gaze. I wanted to kind of break out of that somehow. So that's essentially how the style of the film. And I feel like the commentary that we wrote, I mean, obviously we wrote it for all these serious reasons, but it's a lot of fun to try and write that kind of commentary. So, yeah.
So you talked about how the form is to an extent constrained by very purely economic reasons, right? I wanted to ask you about this other medium that you work in. You do a lot of writing and you write for mainstream newspapers, and now you have a column about love. You have a weekly column called How to Find Indian Love in Mumbai Mirror, right? And you're working on a book on love. So what happens to bigger ideas of love within that column, within a highly politicized environment where suddenly everybody has an opinion about love, right? What happens then week after week?
So the thing is that I actually thought about working on a book about love after making this film, because when I came home and I was editing, I kept feeling, you know, whenever we talk about love, either somebody else is always doing it for us, actually. Movies are doing it. We get, like when I interviewed Gunjali and they say, oh, I don't have any idea of romance, and they're keeping quiet. Actually, they had an idea of romance, which is not, because after pushing them, it just was like something very stock, you know, not really their own idea of romance. They had it in their hearts, but they didn't know how to even say it. And actually, there's no place to say it. Otherwise, we're talking about it in this very politicized context of morality and freedom and whatever. So I thought, oh, maybe there should be a book that just talks about love. But I think the nice thing is, you know, I believe that eventually you have to, I feel in my work, what I'm trying to do is just create these textures. Like, you should, when you read it or watch it, it should fill your body up with some feeling. That feeling should give you a sense of possibility. So with the column, it's actually, even when writing about very politicized things, like now with the love jihad, or when Digvijay Singh's love affair was revealed or whatever, actually I just feel, I write all the time about how love is the thing that is the most political of all. But it's not political because of these things. It's political because it's where people figure out how they want to lead their lives, how they want to behave with other people, how they want to be equal. Like real politics is worked out in these choices of love and how you are with other individuals in your life. So I think the column kind of tries to do that. And sometimes I feel like, oh, should it be cleverer? Should it be smarter? Should it be like Sex and the City? Because then it would be more popular. But interestingly, there's a lot of heartfelt response because I think we don't have enough desi stuff which talks to us about our love lives and our love confusions, right? So I feel like that is a different kind of political intervention. And writing every single week makes it possible not to be so loaded, you know? You can write about small things because you know you're going to do it every week for the next 2 years.
Has there been anything that particularly that people responded to in the last few months within the love column?
See, so last weekend I wrote about girls who cry on trains when they're heartbroken, which had a very strong response. And you know, when I put it up and I posted it, my assistant said that people won't share it because everybody does it, but they don't want to talk about it publicly. But in fact, everybody was relieved to be able to talk about it publicly. Even when the Digvijay Singh thing happened and I wrote about it, people were quite like, very good, because all the people who did it are stupid. And so what you actually see is, you know, that's the other thing. When you do something week after week or with an economy, like 600 word column, a small film, but do a lot of work all the time, I think you discover there's a lot of everybody in the world is not in the for and against category. There's quite a large number of people who are in between, who are trying to figure things out for themselves, who are quite, for lack of a better word, progressive or open. And you get a lot more interaction of that kind happening, which gives me a lot of hope, actually. Or makes me less hopeless, let's say that.
Sure. How are we doing with time? Should we open it up here?
Yeah, we've got about 10 minutes.
Questions?
I've spoken so much. Let me know this.
Hi. My name is Kshitij, and coincidentally, I'm from Meerut only.
Oh. So. Oh no, nothing caught. Inaccuracies.
Yeah. So I wanted to ask this, when this Operation Majnu happened, it was quite long back. Mm. And in the last few years, there have been incidents in Meerut which brought it on the front covers, for example, the rape in the gang rape in Muzaffarnagar of a Meerut girl. And then you saw of a simple sociological or a sociological phenomenon getting hijacked by a political agenda. So when you were making this film, and interviewing these youngsters, were they aware of this consciousness that a simple phenomenon which happens in every other small city is being hijacked, is being turned into spinned into a political phenomenon? And so did you find any of that?
No, because I mean, I don't think people, but I'll say one thing, this idea that something simple is blown up out of proportion or given a spin for some use, but this is a commonplace idea. We all say it. To say it and to not respond or respond to it are two very different things, I feel, right? And in that sense, I would again say that it's not only in Meerut that these things are happening. Because Meerut is a TRP city, it becomes very useful to have it on television. Right? But actually, these things are happening everywhere. Or, to put it another way, if there is a report that says that Bombay has the highest suicide rate, from the next day onwards, suddenly the paper starts reporting many suicides. Now those suicides were happening before, but suddenly the paper becomes aware of them. They were not reporting them in between. So I think that the most interesting thing vis-a-vis Meerut or any other place and the way that politicians use these ideas is that the language of news television has influenced the language of politics in a very major way. So that it becomes impossible. Everything is an event, right? There's an event and it runs in a cycle. So supposing something happens today, it will run in a cycle, continuously on news. You will be in it like when you play a video game, right? You're watching, you can't stop watching. After 2 days, it'll run out because a new cycle will replace it and you will forget that. So actually, there is no sustained conversation about issues and ideas. It's always about an event. And everybody's watching and everybody, it's like a kind of central hub and we're all mesmerized by it and that rhythm of grrr. So we also respond to politics like that. Now in our heart of hearts, we know many things, but we are almost powerless to act on that knowledge right now. So I feel it's very interesting the way that news and politics are interwoven in terms of the language of how people react to ideas. And that would be any other place. I think it must be much harder for people from Meerut because if you see your city always represented like that, you start believing it is like that and you should be like that. So it's a tough, tough place to be in. Should leave, as you have done.
Since nobody can ask one more question. Meerut is surrounded by this farmer belt, and lot of people from the villages come to city for education and all other purposes, and then they see like in a living in a village, and you don't have much chance of what essentially called love and whatever. But we come in a city, then you what?
Sorry.
So
I was thinking of going to Kerala to my cousin's villages and just amazed at how much options they had while I was like surreal in Ranagar in Bangalore. Sorry.
Oh, maybe I don't know about Kerala, but
maybe it's about just not being in the place where you've grown up, right? Like leaving your context in a way.
Yeah, I'm talking about from my village, from my experiences. So when they suddenly come into city, they in colleges, and they find themselves in a new phenomenon. Like the guys you show in the video last in the Archie store, I reckon they also may be from a suburb of Meerut.
Yeah,
so did you find this disjoint between the people coming from Meerut suburbs, their way of thinking, as well as people who are growing up in the city itself? Did you find
this? I'm not like knowledgeable about Meerut. That's not how the film was made, so I cannot really speak for that. But I will say that I recently did a TV series in which there was a girl from Meerut who had come away from home to try to be an actress on television in Bombay. And her story did actually reflect what you're saying, that it's only by leaving town, or leaving, like her family had come from the outskirts. They were farming family, and they had moved there. They lived on the edge, between rural and town like Meerut. And she had been sent to college in Ghaziabad or Noida, I forget now. That was her thing. Like, once she got out, then she fell in love with a boy. Then she like, I'm going to Bombay. So she wanted to get out. Now, when I would talk to her, I would realize she doesn't really know what it is she wants to do. But what she doesn't want to do is be in Meerut at home, where everybody's watching and saying you have to be X type of person, right? And for the people at home, it's very difficult to understand this desire for like just figuring it out. Like that is, it's not even so much kind of moral panic of, oh my God, she'll go and boys and this and that. Some of that fighting used to happen. But more, it's very perplexing that you want to go into the unknown. You want to do things that nobody knows the answer to. There will be complete chaos if you do that. That's not how things are done, right? So if she'll say, okay, mummy, I'm very happy because today I met Honey Singh, her mother will say, uska kya fayda hoga? You know? So this thing of, I want to go out and I want to have a feeling of possibility. I do feel like I did encounter that a little bit, but I won't say that I can make some deep sociological commentary on that. Maybe this is true of many small towns up north especially.
But for this character, Mahima, her sister, who's Garima and who's, what does she do? Taekwondo?
Judo.
Judo, something. So, but that's allowed to leave with this purpose of becoming a butch, judo playing.
Which like, was an Olympic level player, right? So that's also the thing, that if you're going to leave home, you should become a doctor. You should have a job in television. Okay, you should have something which is very visible as a sign of why you have left. You know, so it's kind of like you don't do things just because you feel like doing them. That doesn't make sense. So there is that other kind of scrutiny on you. You should always, if you can leave home and do anything you want, like this girl's sister, because she was playing judo and she was representing India abroad and she was doing really anything she wants. Anything she wants. So it's also very tied into money. A lot of the changes that in a small town, you want to go to the city because you want to have the economic advancement of going into the city. But on the other hand, you feel very panicked that you will lose everything that you are. But I think one of the interesting things also, and I was glad that Subhashree included the film in an urban festival, is because I really think that the most interesting thing that has happened with this kind of sting operation thing is how cities have taken on this way of thinking much more strongly than before. Because it is entering from another place. These displaced TRPs of other towns and provinces are also influencing the moral climate in many cities, which was not very conventionally so before, and reshaping the city.
Hi. So I have a question about the kind of pulp fiction that you featured. I kind of get the feeling that these are very widely read. You see it in a lot of bus stand, chai stops along the highway and a lot of these places. And I also get the feeling that readership is predominantly male. Um, Can you talk a little bit about anything interesting you found in terms of the effect that this type of fiction was having on the readership, and in terms of how they would then look at society?
The readership is not, I mean, it may be largely male, but it has a significant female readership as well. And I think the interesting thing is not that, it's that actually the magazines are less read now. And maybe the Hindi novels are read to an extent. But a lot of that, the pleasure or whatever else of that kind of material has been displaced onto news television. So that's also another reason why it's there, because people want to consume it and it's put somewhere else for you. Of course, like all classic pulp fiction stories, there will be some traditional girls are like this, you know, they cheat you, they do this, or they become wavered.
And love is poison. Huh.
Yeah. So all of that is there. And boys also will articulate that kind of thing. Ved Prakash Sharma, when we interviewed him, said a very interesting thing. He said that he became a popular novelist because he was the first one to bring in an element of the domestic into his novels. That earlier detective fiction was always about, you know, crime and the city and this man, this cop or whatever. But he brought in this kind of what he calls domestic, but what we would say is these elements of love, more female characters. So it made his readership both male and female. And that is why he is so successful. So I think that's an interesting dynamic. It's not very easy to, like, say easily that, you know, there's a classic story of men read these things and develop certain notions of sexuality and women and love and whatever. That happens. The reverse also happens. A lot of the magazines that I read, they are full of, you know, they have very interesting advice columns, because there'll be like a 3-page question. I didn't even realize it's a question. Like, I was reading it, I was totally transfixed, because it was a very kind of pornographic story about a girl's, I started working in the office, then I had sex with my boss, then some other person in the office, but then my mother-in-law came to stay with me and it was wonderful and something. I'm like, why are we hearing about all these sexual escapades? Until she came to her question at the end, which was, now I'm worried that when I get married, I will not have such good sex as I had with my brother-in-law. Can you please solve this for me? I was like, it's amazing, right? So, and the answer that the columnist gave was actually very, very progressive. That you should, it's very nice that you had this positive experience. You should not think you won't have it again. Don't be influenced by what happened to you in the office. But in fact, believe that you will find somebody good. So very complicated things happen inside the magazine. No? So it gives you many pleasures, which are illicit and licit and whatever else. And I almost wish they were read more, because they are kind of fading away now. Yeah.
Sorry, sir, there's just one question here. Sorry.
See, but even if they're cooked up, they're cooked up for a reason. No, there's a readership, they want that thing. So. See, because Meerut, no, that's not only Operation Majnu took me to Meerut. I mean, if Operation Majnu had happened in like Bangalore, I would have come here. You know, it was Operation Majnu. But the fact is that, yeah, so at that moment, Meerut had been included in the NCR just shortly before. So you're obviously experiencing some very rapid economic advancement. I would, however, say that this idea that something is becoming something, you know, something is always becoming something. No, it's never a moment when we are not in transition. Yeah. So the thing is, as soon as we are born, we begin to die. And the city is changing every single minute. It's not changing for you, it's changing for somebody else. So just the way that people in Meerut feel panicked that they are sending their daughters to work in call centers, people in Bombay feel very panicked that nobody likes graceful old Gothic buildings anymore, you know, and the whole of Bombay is going to be destroyed, and Bangalore's beautiful old villas are going to be destroyed. So okay, everything gets destroyed, right? And some people feel frantic about it, and some people don't. And everybody exercises control over somebody else. That's what I think. So I'm not a very big fan of the theory that there are good changes and bad changes. There are changes. There are good parts of those changes and bad parts of those changes. Some things are hard. We just have to suck it up. So the desire to control that change is normally what creates a tremendous amount of crisis and violence, which is what we see happening in Meerut, right? Yeah.
So on that Paulo Coelho note, just
what I wanted to say.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Nisha.